Come on, one more minute. One more minute. Give it all you got. Come on. Hallelujah. Oh, rush it to care. Robo, Bobo, Boko, Robara. Oh, Baba, 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 Elish, it taking
us. Come on. We praise the one. We praise Jesus. Jesus is the light, and where there is light, there can be no darkness. There can be no darkness. Thank you, Father, that you are the light. Thank you, Jesus, that you are the light, and you spread light for every person in this place. We thank you, Father, that we're going to be able to take this light out into the city, and people will be attracted to it, and we'll get to tell them that the love of God is this light. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus.
My soul longs for you, my soul longs for you. Nothing else will do, nothing else will do. My soul longs for you, my soul longs for you. Nothing else will do, nothing else will do. So longs for you, nothing else will do, nothing else will do. My soul longs for you, my soul longs for you. Nothing else will do, nothing else will do.
You'll come like the rain. So we engage you, we engage you, oh, we invade you. All the glory, all the honor, all the power is yours. Yours is the kingdom forever. Amen. We say move, move in glory. Yours is the key.
This is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. Your holy presence is living in me. This is my daily bread. This is my daily bread. Your very word spoken to me, and I'm desperate for you. And I'm lost without you. This is the air I breathe. This is the air I breathe. Your holy presence living in me. This is my daily bread. This is my daily bread. You're there. Thank you. the finder of lost things. He is 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 the healer of the broken body. He is peace for the tormented mind. He is the fixer of the broken hearted. He is the looker of lost things. Yes. He is the finder of lost things. He is the finder of lost things. He is the healer of the broken body. He is peace for the tormented mind. Broken hearted. He is the finder of lost things. He is the finder of lost things. Maybe you find yourself lost this morning. Maybe you're lost without direction. Maybe you've lost your joy. Maybe you've lost your peace. Maybe you've lost your sound mind. But He is the finder of lost things. If we're lost without Him, then the opposite is true. We are found in Him. If we're lost without Him, then we can be found in Him. So if you find yourself lost this morning, or you've lost something, you can find it in Him. You can be found in Him. So instead of saying, I'm lost without You this morning, some of you need to say, God, I am found in You today. I am found in You today. I'm going to find my peace. I'm going to find my joy. I'm going to find my sound mind. I'm going to find my healing. I'm going to find my restoration in Him this morning. Oh, I'm found in You, God. Oh, I'm found in You, God. Oh, I'm found in You, God. Yes, I'm found in You, God. Oh, I'm found in You, God. Yes, I'm found in You, God. Oh, I'm found in You, God. You are the finder of lost things. He is the finder of lost things. He is the finder of lost things. Breathe it in, breathe it in.
Just breathe.
Breathe it in, breathe it in.
Breathe it in. Just breathe. Just breathe.
For someone this morning.
Just breathe.
You've been holding your breath for so long.
Just breathe.
Just breathe in the peace of God this morning.
Just breathe.
Okay, stop. Just breathe in the peace of God. Breathe in the love of God.
Just sit in his presence for a minute. Such a hurry. Sometimes we forget just to stop. Just spend time with them. Let ourselves rest and get peaceful. Let him speak to you. Let him minister to you.
Blessed be the name of the Lord. Just breathe. Just breathe. Just take a big, deep breath in. Hold it for a second. Just release it. Sorrow and sighing shall flee away. Sorrow and sighing shall flee away. You know, sometimes you can go through some things where it settles right down on your chest and in your gut, and it's just hard to take a breath. A punch in the gut. You may hear some news or something. Somebody comes against you with words, or someone has said something against you, or you have a disappointment in life, and you're just unable to take a deep breath. But in Isaiah, it says that he'll make a road in the desert. He'll make every crooked place straight. He'll cause the rose to bloom again in the desert. And sorrow and sighing shall flee away. Just the big sigh, like, oh, I'm overwhelmed. That's fleeing away from you now. He's taking that from you now. It doesn't belong to you. Doesn't belong to you. What does belong to you is grace and empowerment and equipping and authority, and the peace of God shall guard your heart and your mind in Christ Jesus. We're no longer sinners saved by grace. We're the righteousness of God in Christ Jesus. That's right. That's right. And we operate in life from a place of victory, a place of authority, and we are seated with Him, in heavenly places. In the Psalms, it says that he who sits in the heavens laughs. We're seated with him in heavenly places. You get the connection here? The joy of the Lord is your strength, not sorrow and sighing. There is no strength in grief. There is no strength in sorrow. only strength is found in the joy of the Lord. The joy of the Lord. The joy of the Lord is not always laughing, but laughter is included in it. Glory to God. Glory to God. Gone. Sorrow and sighing shall flee away. It's gone. You'll reach for it, but it's not there. You'll look for it, but you can't find it. The only thing lost in this place today is your sin, is your sickness, is your brokenness, is the heaviness that was on you. I can't find it. Does anybody else do the pat down when you're leaving? And make sure you have your keys and your wallet and your phone and all that stuff. And if something's missing, you what do? You go look for it, or you pat it again or whatever. Look in your purse. You may look in the same spot over and over again, even though you've just looked there and you know it's not there. You look, I can't find it, I can't find it. That's the way your sin is. That's the way your brokenness is. That's the way your sickness is. That's the way your disappointment is. I stop looking for it. Stop looking for it. Your life is now to be enjoyed without that. Say, but what will I pray about? Oh, we've got stuff. We got stuff. When you no longer have that stuff, you go looking for it on someone else. Say, this doesn't belong to you. This doesn't belong to you. Let go of it. Doesn't belong to you. Doesn't belong to you. There was a guy in the Bible that talks. You guys can be seated for a second. For a second. Maybe a few minutes. You just stay right here for a minute. For a few more minutes. There was a guy in the Bible that he had borrowed an axe. He was cutting down a tree, and when he went to cut down this tree, the axe head fell off the handle, and it went into the water, and it sunk. And Elisha came up and said, "What's going on? Why are you so troubled? Why are you so afraid?" He goes, "I borrowed this axe, and it's now lost, and he's going to have to repay, and he doesn't have any money to repay it." He said, "Where is the thing? Where did it fall?" In other words, where did it fall into the water? And I would ask you that. Where the thing that you lost that you want back? Have you ever had something that you lost that you want back? I'm not talking about, you know what I'm talking about. Has anybody ever lost something that you want back? Maybe the devil stole that. We're going to go after that here for a few minutes. We lost some of the stuff, you know, we lost all the stuff, the heaviness, all that stuff. We're not looking for that. I'm looking now for the stuff that the devil has stolen from you, or that you lost through surrender to the enemy, that you want it back. That you want it back. Elisha said, where is that thing that you lost? Where did it fall? Think back, if you can. If you can, think back where it fell. Where did you lose it? Where did you lose it? And so when he showed him it was right here in the water, he said he took a stick and he cast it in the water. In the Old Testament, there's types and symbols of Jesus and the cross. This was the cross. We now apply that cross wherever you lost that thing. We overlay it. We overlay the cross on that which you lost. This cool thing happened. The iron axe head floated on the water. Floated on the water. So we're going to make those things that you lost float to the top, so you can reach in and grab it. If you want it. Have you ever gotten something that you prayed for and you realize, oh my gosh. Anybody else do that besides me? Yeah. Make sure you want it. Because it's going to float to the top. It's going to float to the top in the next, maybe in the next few minutes, maybe in the next few hours, maybe in the next few weeks, months or years. It will float to the top to where it will be returned back to you. And you reach in and you grab it and you take a hold of it. Do you have anything like that? Maybe it's a son or a daughter. Maybe it's a relationship that you want back. Some of those, you want them to stay at the bottom of the river, I guess. Did I just say that out loud? Maybe you lost money in a deal. Maybe you lost a contract, a job, something like that. It's going to make it come float to the top. Amen. An opportunity similar to that. Am I talking to anybody? Maybe this is just for me. You're getting quiet on me here. Like, what is he talking about? In the name of Jesus, we cause those things that are lost to float to the top. We apply the cross. Redeem it. Redeem it. Redeem the day. Many of you have lost whole days and weeks and months because someone that you loved died on that day or died in that month, and you dread that day. You dread that month. He's going to redeem the day. He's going to redeem the day. He's going to redeem the month. He's going to redeem the year. He will make it up to you. He'll make it up to you if you want him to. This is the air I breathe. What kind of air are you breathing? Defeat, disappointment. This is the air I breathe. Total victory. Total restoration. Total redemption. I don't want partial redemption. I don't want to just get saved and that's good enough for me. I want the whole thing. I want all that he has for me. And I want it restored. Maybe someone has made fun of the gifting on your life. And so you just shut down. I want it back. I want it back. Does anybody else want it back? Praise God. This is the air I breathe. This is the air that you breathe. This is the air that you're breathing in this room. Glory, power, presence, healing. Restoration, redemption, reconciliation, financial supply. That's the air I breathe. What is it that makes you sigh? What is it that makes you close down? It's gone. There is a good sigh, a sigh of relief. He came through. Whew, that thing got paid off. Whew, that bill, that money came in. Whew, that relationship got restored. Whew, that cancer left. Whew, that good report came. I feel the wind on that. Feel the wind on that. Feel the wind on that. Whew. Yeah, sing that. Go ahead and sing into that.
I'm taking it back. I'm taking it back. I'm taking it back.
Come on, stand to your feet. Let's take it back. Let's take a stand.
I'm taking it back. I'm taking it back. I'm taking it back. I'm taking it back.
Praise God. Come on.
I'm taking it back. I'm
Take a stand. Take it back.
I'm taking it back. I'm taking it back. I'm taking it back.
Draw a line in the sand.
I'm taking it back. I'm taking it back. I'm taking it back. I'm taking it back. I'm taking it back.
Come on, take your marriage back. This building on Tuesday is a polling place. This whole area will come here and vote. They think they're coming in here to vote, but really God's just drawn them into the presence. The presence never leaves. The presence never leaves. And so we just pray that the presence of God would rest upon them, would rest upon them, would draw them in to Jesus, that they would get saved, they would get healed, just by coming to vote, just by coming to vote. Praise God, praise God. Glory to God. The veil would be removed from their eyes, that they would realize there's a church in their neighborhood where the presence of God rests upon his people. Amen. And the love of God would be so strong in this place that people that feel unloved when they come to vote, they would just think something is different about this place. It's because of you guys. Because of the Holy Ghost that rests on your life. Glory to God. Glory to God. Let's lift our hands one more time. In Jesus' name, we receive the peace of God. We receive the reconciliation of God. We receive the award, the rewards of our faith. Father God, we receive and we will see the answers to every prayer that was prayed in this region for an outpouring of your Holy Spirit. Let it come to pass in this generation, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. You guys can be seated. You guys can be seated. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Praise God. Blessed be the name of the Lord. We're going to receive this morning's offering. Address up there on the screen to give online if you'd like to do it that way, or if you want to give cash or a check, there's envelopes in a bucket out in the corner of the lobby. You can give there. Praise God. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. I'm telling you, the glory of God is here. The glory of the Lord is here. Glory to God. Glory to God. Hallelujah.
My trouble, and now I give it back to the owner, for God, which is you, from whence my strength comes. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Father, for the joy.
Glory to God.
My strength is greater now.
Thank you, Lord. Glory to God. Amen. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Blessed be the name of the Lord. Second Kings, chapter 6. Second Kings, chapter 6, verse 8. Start there. I'm going to read this. And we may never get through it. But at least we got our finger in the page. 2 Kings 6, verse 8. I'm going to go ahead and begin reading. Now the king of Syria was making war against Israel, and he consulted with his servants, saying, "My camp will be in such and such a place." And the man of God sent to the king of Israel, saying, "Beware that you do not pass this place, for the Syrians are coming down there." Then the king of Israel sent someone to the place of which the man of God had told him. Thus he warned him, and he was watchful there, not just once or twice. Therefore the heart of the king of Syria was greatly troubled by this thing, and he called his servants and said to him, "Will you not show me which of us is for the king of Israel?" One of his servants said, "None, my lord, O king, but Elisha the prophet who is in Israel tells the king of Israel the words that you speak in your bedroom." That's scary right there, isn't it? Shouldn't be. Doesn't say Selah there, but we say Selah right now. So he said, "Go and see where he is, that I may send and get him." And it was told him, saying, "Surely he is in Dothan." Just backing up a verse. You thought we was past that, didn't you? Backing up a verse. God will tell you the things that your enemy speaks of in his bedroom. God, the Holy Spirit on the inside of you, will tell you things that your enemy is plotting against you in the very early stages. Amen. Praise God.
Praise God.
That's a good thing.
Yes.
Praise God. So don't get nervous that he's telling me what you're saying in your bedroom. I don't care what you're saying in your bedroom. I don't care what you're saying in your kitchen. Praise God. That was funnier than you thought it was. So he said, go and see where he is that I may send and get him. And it was told him, saying, surely he is in Dothan. Well, back up to that verse again. The reason I don't care what you say about in your bedroom is because you're not my enemy. Have you ever gone to a prophetic conference and gotten nervous that the prophet or the person speaking that flowed with the Holy Ghost was going to read your mail or read your thoughts or call you out and just embarrass you? And has anybody ever done that, or is that just me? The key is to not have those thoughts. But you probably will get called out more if you wear a red shirt or a yellow shirt. I'm just saying. If that helps you. If you want to get called out, wear those two color shirts and they'll call you out. Therefore, he sent horses and chariots and a great army there, and they came by night and surrounded the city. And when the servant of the man of God arose early and went out, there was an army surrounding the city with horses and chariots. And his servant said to him, alas, my master, what shall we do? So the king of the Syrian army had found out it was Elisha telling his secrets or finding out his secrets. So he sent a great army to surround him, to intimidate him, to kill him, to bring him back. And so here he is coming out of the tent. His servant comes out of the tent and says, we're surrounded. What shall we do? So verse 16, so he answered, do not fear. First of all, when you are surrounded, do not fear. Amen. That's easier said than done. See, in the Old Testament, they speak of nations and people being your enemies, and they were being the enemies of Israel. In the New Covenant, our enemies aren't people, our nations, they're demons, devils, and spirits. And so we don't kill people, just to be clear. We don't kill nations, just to be clear. We go after the spirits that are driving the people, whether they're possessing the people, influencing the people, oppressing the people. We go after the spirits, and once you disconnect the spirit from the person, then they have no power or authority or access into your life. And so your first attempt is to cast the devil out of the person. If the person doesn't want the devil cast out of them, then you cast the person out of your company. You do. And so, but your first shot is at the devil. And most people want help. So he answered, do not fear, for those who are with us are more than those who are with them. And Elisha prayed and said, Lord, I pray, open his eyes that he may see. Then the Lord opened the eyes of the young man, and he saw. And behold, the mountain was full of horses and chariots of fire all around Elisha. The presence and the power of the Lord is here, whether you see it or not. And so it becomes an exercise, if you will. It says in the New Testament, it says that we learn how to discern both good and evil exercising, through exercise, through not physical exercise, thank goodness. But if you exercise, that's great. I'm not, you know. Thank goodness that's not a requirement to see in the spirit. But you exercise your faith. You exercise releasing your faith. You exercise ministering to people. And through that exercise, that repetition, that of resistance, you get strong in your faith, exercising that faith so that when you really need it, because you don't really need it in the gym when you're exercising. You don't really need it in the gym, right? That's not why you're exercising. That's not why you need your, golly, I need some experts here on physical exercise. Why do I get pulled into sports analogies and exercise? I don't know. But anyways, in the gym, you don't need to be strong in the gym. You need to be strong while you're working out after the gym. Punch somebody in love. To rescue somebody, to lift somebody's groceries out of the car. How's that? That's a better example. The soldier doesn't need to be brave in boot camp. And he's being trained to be brave in battle. I've never been in the service either. So when you're training, when God's training you, here's what I'm trying to say. When God is training you and there's resistance, if you won't succumb to the resistance and you won't surrender to the resistance of your faith, but you exercise your faith through repetition, and sometimes you hit it and sometimes you don't, you'll be strong in the battle when it's really needed. You'll realize you're stronger than you think. Have you ever pushed against something really big and it just didn't seem to move? I mean, even spiritually. You got big things in your life and you just push on that and you believe for it and you just resist it and you're trying to move it and it's just there. It's just not moving. But you then take that same strength and try to move something really small and you realize it was in the pushing of the big that made me strong, and it's easier to push the small out of the side. It opened my servant's eyes that he may see. And it says the Lord opened his eyes and he saw. That sounds like blind Bartimaeus. What do you want me to do for you? I want my sight. Receive your sight. And he saw. Praise God. I feel like I need to minister that right now. If you've had spiritual blind spots, where you're too close to it and you've tried to take care of it in the natural, and you go to look for faith to change it, and it just seems like this is the big rock in your life and you're not able to move it, but someone else can come right in and just like, I see that. Here's what's going on. Boom, and moves it out of the way. I want your eyes opened. I want my eyes opened to every spiritual blind spot so that I'm not just walking through life. Everybody else sees it but me. Everybody else sees it but you. Anybody want to get rid of that? You don't have to raise your hand. It's like, I'll take it right here. Over here, Lord. Do not pass me by. I love Old Covenant. but I'd like to drag it through the cross. Ephesians 1, 15. Therefore, I also, after I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and your love for all the saints, is that anybody in here? Yeah. So he's talking about the believer, right? Amen. Do not cease to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayers, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give to you the spirit of wisdom and revelation and the knowledge of him. Here it is. The eyes of your understanding being enlightened or flooded with light, that you may know what is the hope of his calling and what are the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints. May your eyes be flooded with light. Let my eyes be flooded with light. We're going to seesaw here. Psalm 103. What is the glory of his inheritance in the saints? Psalm 103. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and all that is within me. Bless his holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul, and forget not all his benefits. Here is your benefit package. Here is your benefit package. He who forgives all your iniquities. That's all of them. That's all your iniquities. All your iniquities. You're free. You shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. But it's the knowledge of that truth. It's the eyes of your understanding. You shall know the truth, the eyes of my understanding. You've heard it said this way, the light came on. I understand it now. The light bulb came on. The light came on. I can see. If I'm looking for something in a room, I don't first go in there and try to find it myself in the dark. I turn the light on, and it makes it so much easier to walk directly to where it's at and pick it up. May your eyes be flooded with light so that you can walk directly into the room God has prepared for you. In my Father's house are many rooms. Oh, my gosh. Here we go. In my Father's house are many rooms. He said, if it weren't so, I would have told you so. Jesus would have told us. That's not really true. There's not that many rooms. He said, if it weren't true, I would have told you so. Where is the room that God has prepared for you? Make sure the light is turned on in the room he's called you to. So that you can walk directly over to it and pick up the benefit package. Who forgives all your iniquity. He heals all your diseases. He redeems your life from destruction. Oh, but wait, I thought God used destruction to teach me a lesson. I don't even know if this is a good song. Don't stone me if the lyrics are raunchy. But this one, you remember the song? I'm pulling from my 1980s resource playlist. Cassettes. Remember that song, "She Blinded Me with Science"? I hope that doesn't have a bad meaning. But so many of us have been blinded with natural knowledge. We've been blinded with natural knowledge that we think everything that happens in our life is from God, and it's God's will. Not, that's what religion will tell you when they don't have the answer. They'll make up a doctrine to support their dysfunction and subpar living. Turn the lights on. Let our eyes be flooded with light. You shall know the truth. The light comes on. you understand something. We understand that these are the benefits of the Lord. These aren't the curses of the Lord. There are no curses of the Lord. Jesus became the curse for us so that the blessings of God would come upon us, the Gentiles, those without a covenant, can now have a covenant with God because of the blood Jesus, the blood of Jesus that was shed for us. So these are the benefits that he redeems our life from destruction. If there's destruction in your life, let's drag it through the cross. The thief comes not but what? Steal, kill, and destroy. That sounds like destruction to me. That's not the whole verse. It says, but I've come that you might have life and have it more abundantly. Which sounds like Ephesians, I'll do exceedingly, what? Abundantly, above all that you ask or think. So whatever you're thinking right now, it's more than that. And then when you can think more than that, it's more than that. It always exceeds your thinking. It's exceedingly above that. It's exceedingly more than that. And when you know that truth, it'll set you free from a life of destruction, a life of sickness, a life of disease, a life of iniquity. That's the benefit. It pays to serve God.
Amen.
I know I'm here. Somebody's saying, but yeah, it says we're no longer servants of the Lord. We're friends. We're called friends. Yeah, we're friends of God as well, but you never lose the servant, being a servant of God.
Right.
Looking for friendly fire out in the audience here. Friendly fire. Who crowns you with loving kindness and tender mercies, not harsh wrath, condemnation. He satisfies your mouth with good things. In Proverbs, it says that death and life are in the power of the tongue. James says, let's drag it through the cross. In the book of James, it says, if you can control your tongue, you can change the whole course of a ship. It's like a rudder.
Yeah.
With a little rudder.
Yeah.
The whole ship is turned. Where's your ship sailing? Where's your ship sailing? Turn it with that little rudder in your mouth. Because it says in James, it says that that same tongue can set on course in nature fires. Well, you can do, you can look at that good or bad. You can start fires through rumors and gossip and all that stuff and angst and talking about people and stuff like that. Or you can release the fire of God. Fire of God. He redeemed your tongue in the book of Acts. He redeemed your tongue in the book of Acts. Set upon each one of them tongues of fire. They began to speak in a language they didn't understand themselves, but the Spirit of God knew what he was talking about. The Spirit of God prays out the perfect will of God in your life. So if you don't understand something, you can... I don't know about you, but I can pray in English maybe 3 to 5 minutes. Maybe, and that's a long prayer. I mean, that's not something you do at Thanksgiving or Christmas when you're around family. They ask you to bless the meal. You don't get your whole family preached to, you know, through the family meal. Where was I? Oh, if you can only pray in English just a few minutes and you don't have that release, you begin to pray in a language where the Spirit of God prays through you, the perfect will of God, because your mind is unfruitful. It it can't produce any more fruit with your known language, so you pray in the Holy Spirit language, and he prays out the perfect will of God. You all know that, right? I like this one. So that your youth is renewed like the eagles. Praise God. Youth is renewed like the eagles. Youth is renewed like the eagles. Bless the Lord. Oh, my soul. Oh, my soul. What is your soul? Your mind, your will, and emotion. See, you all know this stuff. You all know this stuff. But what happens if we become overly familiar with? What if you ate Oreo cookies every day for the rest of your life? You would be overly familiar with it, and it would be a habit. Versus it tastes great. If you ate steak every day, you would eventually, I know it's hard to believe, you would think you would eventually get tired of eating steak. It's a variety. Come on, stick with me. You stuck with me through the exercise and the military and the sports. I know everybody here eats. No idea. The Oreos threw me off. I don't know what I was going to say. But it's a variety. We become overly familiar with things we just spout out as just little cliched sayings. And then they have no meaning because you don't put any faith in it. It's just something that we just say, and they call it Christianese, and it's just, we have our own language, and I know what you mean, you know what I mean, but the world looks at it as funny, like, I have no idea what you're talking about. But you can read some of these scriptures that you've read maybe for years, maybe even decades, and you just skim over it because, like, oh, I've heard that, or I'm really familiar with that, or the movement that I grew up in. Did anybody else grow up in a movement? Like, not a cult, but a movement. A movement, you know, where you just listen to those certain types of preachers and that kind of a flow. And anybody? Anybody? Besides me, it's just me. I'm just going to go home and listen to my big suitcase full of cassettes. And the movement that I grew up in, Mark 11, 22, 23, and 24, was spoken of at almost every message. And after a while, you think, you know, you're in a good spot. You're right down there in the thick of it. You should be loving it. But be real honest with you, I got bored with it. I became overly familiar with it because I wasn't doing it. I wasn't doing it.
There you go.
I just wanted to have itching ear. Come on, give me something new. Give me something deep. Uh-uh. Prophesy over me. See, I got the yellow shirt on. Call me out. Call me to the nations. Tell me how big my church is going to be.
Come on.
And then you become overly familiar with that. I'm saying crack the crust off of the Word of God that you overly know and let it be the bread of life where you just like, oh my gosh, this is like I've never tasted before. This is just, oh my gosh. And so this is, you know, I've been in this for a while. I heard the other day a preacher teaching on Mark 11, 22, 23, and 24, it was the son of one of the generals that I grew up in. And I'm like, oh my gosh, I'm just going to listen because see what he has to say. And it's like I never heard it before. I bought his book. On faith. I mean, come on. But it was so fresh, and it was so new. It was so, oh my gosh, this is what I've been trying to do out of habit is now coming out of my, if I believe in my heart, what I say will come to pass. Glory to God. So I would challenge you. You know, I know a lot of you grew up in a lot of different movements. And you've introduced me to these other movements, and I love them. I love them all. But I would challenge you to go back into some of the key scriptures and phrases that they spoke over your life and break it open again like you've never read it before. There's no points for reading the whole Bible. Except in Sunday school. But there is reward for reading the Word of God, what the Spirit of God is directing you into, and listening to what He's saying this time that you read it. Praise God. That was kind of a shotgun blast there. I hope you got something. If you're here for the first time and maybe you've never received the Lord and maybe not, you don't have to understand it all. You just, there's something inside you that says, I want what they were singing about. What they're talking about, what's going on in this place. I want that in my life. I want some answers. I want that relationship with Jesus. If you're here and you've never had that, or maybe you've had that and maybe walked away and you just want to renew it, you just want to let God know, hey, I'm back. I'm back. I'm like the axe head floated to the top. If you're here this morning and you just right where you're standing, I'm not going to call you forward or just raise your hand so that those maybe around you could see you or I can see you. Just raise your hand that you just want everything. I just want to make sure everything's okay between you and God, whether it's the first time or 100 times. Anybody? Would you guys just receive this prayer? I'm going to pray over you guys. Father, in the name of Jesus, just touch every heart, every soul, every mind, every emotion that we may have. Holy Spirit, flood our eyes with light. Even today, give us a revelation on what's going on around us. Going on in us, what's happening in our family, our families, this nation. Give us eyes to see, ears to hear, hearts to receive that which you have, all that you have for us. In Jesus' name, amen. 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 You guys are dismissed. We'll see you Wednesday.